this mic. That is the reacting. That is a record of this one. I don't know what happened. So we'll start. We have started the recording the video. Now the idea is that magnetic force, the topic is magnetic force and torque on torque between two parallel currents. This is the topic of discussion we are doing. So this is the part of moving charges and magnetism. So this is the topic. So we'll see what it is actually. Force on a current carrying conductor. Force on a current carrying conductor in a uniform magnetic field magnetic field. So we will get the expression F is equal to BIL. So that is the expression we are going to get. How is it? We will see. F is equal to magnetic field into I into L. This is the idea. That is the L is the length of the conductor. So we will see that how it is. So the first point, point number one. So I have the charts. Oh, I am not audible. Hello. Hello. So please respond.
You're audible, sir.
Okay, okay. Someone gave a message that I am not audible. So if such issue is there, please log in once again. So no problem. So here, let me put up the first point. Point number one. When a current carrying conductor is placed in a uniform magnetic field, magnetic field of B Tesla. B Tesla is the uniform magnetic field what we have placed. Okay. So what is actually Tesla? I will tell you. One Tesla is Newton by ampere into meter. That is Tesla. So it is one of the difficult unit. I think I forgot about this. Newton, ampere inverse, meter inverse. This is Tesla. One Tesla is Newton, ampere inverse, meter inverse. This is what you have to keep in mind. When a current carrying conductor is placed in a uniform magnetic field of B Tesla, then due to motion of electrons, that is, in fact, free electrons will be there in the conductor. So the motion of free electrons inside the conductor, inside the conductor. Conductor. A magnetic force. Magnetic force is applied on the conductor. So you have to remember one thing here, the case of magnetic field. So I'll tell you one thing after noting this point, I'll tell you one important point which you have to remember always. Once noted, please let me know. Finished. I hope you will have finished this. We'll hear this. Now, what is the important point you have to remember is when a charged particle is at rest under motion. Why it is so? You see, F is equal to Q into V bar cross V bar. This is the most important thing. And now you see, at rest, V is equal to zero. When V is equal to zero, this is magnetic force. The magnetic force, F magnetic, is zero when the particle is at rest. And now when it is in the motion, V is not equal to zero, then you have the magnetic force. This is F bar magnetic. That will be Q times V bar cross V bar. So that exists. The magnetic force exists when you have V is non-zero. This is the very important point which you have to know. Now, can I clear this? What is the point? So, I will give the expression. So, the thing is that there is a conductor of cross-sectional area A. The electrons are moving like this. So you can assume the electron movement is like this. Electrons are moving like this. And now, you know that opposite to the electron flow, the current will flow opposite to the electron flow. You all know that. And now here, what is the force acting on the conductor is given by BIL sine theta. So this is the expression. Or this is in the scalar form. Okay. The vector form is given by F bar is equal to, this is derivation is not that important. So I'm skipping that. So I into B bar cross L bar. B bar cross L bar. That is the expression what you have to remember. So if theta is equal to 0 degrees or 180 degrees. When this happens, you will have the force acting on the conductor is 0. The magnetic force acting on the conductor is 0. Why? you see this, if B bar is in this direction, same as the direction of the current flow, then there is no effect. But B bar, when it is perpendicular like this, this is the direction of B bar, this is the direction of the current flow. When this happens, right, then you will feel the maximum force. So the maximum is obtained when theta is equal to 90 degrees. Okay. So the F max will happen when theta is 90. Then in that condition, the magnitude is given by BIL. So this is the expression which you have to remember. So these are the things which you have to remember. Just make a note. Now the right hand rule. So this is like the cross product, okay? Right hand rule will use this. So what is this right hand rule? I think I already discussed this. This is the thumb you place in the direction of the current. Okay. Place your thumb in the direction of current. And the curl of the fingers about it will give the direction of the magnetic field. This is the direction. Curl of the fingers will show the direction of the magnetic field. So this one we have already discussed. So I'm doing this once again. So the curl of the fingers will show the direction of the magnetic field. This is the conductor. Okay. This is the one. So it's the same as the vectors what you do, because the cross product is over there. Like what you do, the screw rule. You can apply the same screw rule to get this direction. Okay. Place your thumb in the direction of the current and the fingers, curl the fingers over the conductor, that gives the direction of the magnetic field. So this is what you have to remember. We have the next one on this question. Force between two parallel current carrying conductors. This is the next topic. Now for this, force between two current carrying conductors. So here, why this happens is that, you see, there are two wires like this. When the current is flowing in the first wire is I1, the current flowing in the second wire is I2, this produces magnetic field. This also produces magnetic field. Because both the conductors will produce magnetic field, there exists some force between the two conductors. We need to find the force between the two conductors. So let us say that what we calculate is here, force per unit length is what we calculate. unit length. Remember this point, very important. Here what we calculate is force per unit length. That's one of the most important point. So we consider two conductors. Let us say this is A1, B1, and the second conductor is A2, B2. And this is having a current of I1, this is having a current of I2. Okay. And they are at a distance of R apart, R meter, we can assume R meter apart. They are at a distance of R meter apart. So magnetic field, because of the on one conductor, you can say it is because of the conductor, the magnetic field we have calculated using the Ampere's rule, mu naught I1 divided by 2 pi r. This is the relation what we have done. So at a distance of r, we can calculate this. So let us say this is my B1. And now the force per unit length, force per unit length this is the field experienced by the second wire. This is the field experienced by the second wire. Okay. And you can calculate the force per unit length. F is equal to field force per unit length on second wire. Second wire is because of the first wire. This first wire will produce a magnetic field. Because of that, the second wire will feel the force. So what would be the force? So that will be B1. That is a magnetic field because of the first conductor. And I2 is the current flowing through that. I2. And again, times L. Times L. This is the force per unit length we will consider. And now that is the one. And so we will plug in the... So this will call as the force on the second conductor, F2 is B1 into I2 into L. So the B1, if we substitute, what I get is mu naught by 4 pi into 2 I1 I2 by R times L. 2 I1 I2 by R times L. So I will write in fresh. The force on the second conductor is because of the magnetic field from the first conductor into current passing through the second conductor times L. So B1 is mu naught by 4 pi into 2 I1 divided by R times the current I2 times L. So when you plug in the things, so this is what you get, mu naught by 4 pi into 2 I1 I2 divided by R times L. This is what you get. This is the force F2. And see, F2 by L is what we had to find. F2 by L, that is the force per unit length. Force per unit length is what we will find. Force per unit length. Force per unit length is what we had to find. Okay. Now, it happens to be F2 by L is mu naught by 4 pi into 2 I1 I2 divided by R. This is what we mean. Similarly, so what would be the F1 by L? We'll write afresh. F1 by L and F2 by L will produce the same quantity mu naught by 4 pi into 2 I1 I2 divided by R. This is the force on force per unit length on each conductor because of the second conductor. So here we have one point. So this is force per unit length. We'll call it as single quantity F. F here is force per unit length. So when I'm calling force per unit length, this Newton meter inverse is what you have to remember. Newton meter inverse. Okay, Newton per meter. So the value here is force per unit length, you have to remember. And now here one important point. Two linear parallel conductors carrying currents in the same direction will attract each other. So most important point, this is attract each other. So if the currents are flowing in opposite direction, if the currents are flowing in opposite direction, they repel each other. So this is what you have to know. They repel each other. Clear? So can I clear? Once finished, please let me know. One stage, please let me know. This. The next one is definition of ampere. Define ampere. Define ampere. This is a question. One ampere is the current. which flows through each of the through each of the two parallel uniform long linear conductors which are placed in free space at a distance of 1 meter from each other and which attract or repel each other with a force of 1 meter. Okay. 1 newton per meter. I have to guess. That is force per unit length of their lengths. So this is the definition of ampere. So it's like 1 ampere is the current which flows through the conductors, each of the conductors. Suppose they are flowing in the same direction like this, they attract each other. Suppose they flow in the opposite directions, the conductors will repel each other. And in such case, if the force per unit length is about 1 newton meter inverse, then we would say that the current flowing through the conductors is about 1 ampere. So that's how it is defined. I think I have given 1 newton. So sorry, not 1 newton per meter. It's about, so if I put the value, that's actually, so 1 meter apart. So when I plug in the things, that is force of 2 into 10 to the power of -7 newton meter inverse. Sorry for the correction, please correct it. This is 2 into 10 power minus 7 newton meter inverse. So this much should be the force. It's not 1 newton per meter, it is 2 into 10 power minus 7 newton meter inverse. So we have to plug in the things in the definition. This is not 1 newton meter inverse, that is 2 into 10 to the power of minus 7 newton meter inverse. This should be the force. Then we'll say it is 1 ampere. So please note it. This is the correction. Please correct it. So this, I miscalculated that. It's not 1 newton meter inverse. It is 2 into 10 power minus 7 newton meter inverse. Should be the force. We'll get to that. It's very easy. So here the force per unit length is mu naught by 4 pi into 2 I1 I2 divided by R, right? So substitute the things. If I1 is equal to I2 is equal to 1 amp and R is equal to 1 meter, the mu naught by 4 pi value is 10 to the power of minus 7. So if I plug in the things, the force have to be 2 into 10 to the power of minus 7 newton meter inverse. Okay, this value is newton meter inverse. So the force have to be newton meter inverse, this much, 2 into 10 power minus 7 newton meter inverse. If the current flowing through the conductor, flowing through the conductor. The conductors is he's 1 ampere. So I miscalculated. Sorry for that. You please change the correction. Now I'll solve some problems. So once finished, please let me know. So I hope you would have written this part. Let me clear. And now we'll solve one problem. So I think we are getting a timeout now. Okay. So we'll log in once again. We'll log in once again.